It's easy to say what's the biggest invention I've seen during my lifetime, and that is the internet. It is one of the very few truly global things we have. And when we speak about the future, it's clear that the internet will be one of the biggest things shaping our future. But the internet is just a reflection of the real world. Just like we have problems in the real world, just like we have crime in the real world. Yes, it's true, we have problems online as well. And the biggest threats I see for the future of the internet are threats related to privacy, threats related to internet censorship, and threats related to cyber attacks or online crime. Now, I've spent the last 20 years researching online crime, catching online criminals, analyzing viruses, trojans, backdoors. The situation has changed quite a bit during these years. Right now, the problems are bigger than ever before. In fact, I believe the whole future of the internet is at stake unless we are able to fix the problems we're facing. But if you want to understand these problems, and if you want to understand how do we have to fight these problems, we have to understand where they are coming from. So I'd like to present to you the enemy. I believe we have three main enemies who are causing the online attacks we're seeing today. We have organized cyber gangs, cyber criminal gangs, we have hacktivists, and then we have nation states launching these attacks. So let's take a look. Online criminal crime gangs. And these guys are easy to define because their motive is very, very clear. These guys are doing their attacks to make money. And money is a very good motive for anybody. That's the way it works. These guys write viruses to make money. There are actually millionaires online right now who have become millionaires by writing viruses. In fact, this photo is a real photo found during an investigation showing a photo online criminals had taken themselves of the stash of money they've stolen. But how does this all work? Well, the internet is global. The criminals can be anywhere in the world. In the real world, you only have to worry about the criminals who basically live in your city. When you go online, you have to worry about criminals who can be anywhere in the world. And these guys have become very organized. For example, you can find websites like iframe.biz right here, which is a website run from St. Petersburg, Russia. And these guys cooperate with virus writers. They don't actually write viruses themselves, but they will buy access to infected computers infected by other virus writers. So if you are capable of writing viruses or trojans and infecting other people's computers, but don't really know what to do with those computers, you can simply sell those computers to these guys, and they'll pay you money for access to infected home computers, infected corporate computers. The money depends on where the computer is. The most valuable ones are in North America. And you can sort of see the lifestyle they're imposing and showing to virus writers. You know, write viruses, become rich, buy a BMW, impress girls. That's the kind of thing. But is it really like that? Do virus writers really earn such a good money and live a lifestyle like that? Well, actually, it's sort of true. Here's Albert Gonzalez, known online as Segwek, hacking away at the penthouse suite of, I believe, the Peninsula Hotel in New York, which is the most expensive hotel in New York, I believe. Here's his partner in crime, Mr. Stephen Watt, partying away at the private pool of, I believe, the W Hotel in New York with a bottle of Moet. Now, these guys were Americans, but of course, these are global problems, and not nearly all of these attackers are coming from there. In fact, the most active countries would be Russia, Ukraine, Kazakhstan, and so forth. So here, from Kiev in Ukraine, Mr. Dmitry Golubov, and next to his, Mr. Vladimir Chachin from the city of Tartu in Estonia. So how do these guys then actually make the money? Well, with attacks like banking trojans, which will sit on your computer collecting or modifying your information when you do online banking. You think you're paying your bills, you're actually transferring money to their accounts. Or with things like keyloggers. Keyloggers will infect your PC, and of course, typically it's a Windows PC, because that's what they like to target, because it's the biggest target. And a keylogger would silently sit on your infected computer, recording everything you type, including, you know, every Google search you do, every email you type, every password you type. But what they're really looking for are sessions where you go and do online shopping. Because when you go and buy something online, you will be typing in your name, your address, your credit card number, expiration date, and the security code. Which of course means anyone else who collected this information can now make purchases as well. And this is how most of the credit card theft nowadays is done. It's no longer being done by copying physical cards in the real world. It's being done by stealing the information from your keyboards. So that's enemy number one. Organized criminal gangs operating globally. Then we have hacktivists. Social activists who do their activism online. And obviously, the best-known example would be Anonymous. In fact, I know there are members of Anonymous in the audience right now. Like they say, we are all Anonymous. We are all members, and none of us are members of this non-organization. Organization which has no clear structure, no clear leadership, no clear membership roster. What is common is that they have these same forums and chat systems through which they organize two different operations. But these operations might have completely different membership or completely different leaders and different motives. It's like an amoeba, it keeps changing structure. So when we look at the Anonymous as a whole, it's best known for attacks like defending WikiLeaks with denial of service attacks, which took down Visa.com and Mastercard.com after they shut money traffic or donation traffic to WikiLeaks, or for attacks against Sony. After Sony made Anonymous angry, they've been hacked. Well, they were last hacked yesterday, which was the 17th time they've been hacked this year. So it is pretty astonishing. But who are these people, really? Like, who are these members of this non-organization? Well, he wanted to find out. His name is Aaron Barr. He used to be the CEO of a US company called HB Gary Federal, which is a security company. They specialized in doing security consulting and advice and software development for US government and US military. One of the things they specialized in was intelligence gathering from social networks. Mr. Aaron Barr himself was an expert in this, collecting information from services like LinkedIn and Facebook and building profiles and collecting intelligence. So he decided to infiltrate Anonymous. He became one of them. He took multiple different personas, went to the same chat systems, same boards, spent extended time there, weeks and weeks, becoming a trusted member of the community, collecting information and intelligence, nicknames, IP addresses, real-world addresses, real-world names. Then he decided to go public with his research. He actually gave an interview to the Forbes magazine where he explained he's done all this research and he's about to go public with all this research. He's going to have a speech at a security conference in San Francisco. And he gave this interview on Friday. He was due to give the talk on Tuesday next week. He never did. Because during this weekend, he was hacked. His Facebook account was hacked, his Twitter account was hacked, his Gmail account was hacked, the website of HB Gary Federal was defaced with messages from the Anonymous, the HB Gary Federal file servers were breached, their email server was breached, and the whole email history of this company, since the beginning of the company, was stolen and published online. In fact, it's still online today, complete with its own search engine, which means anybody, including any of you, can right now go and read through the emails of this company, make searches for example, Dutch companies and see what they've interacted with this company, and read every single email, including all the private emails, all the secret emails, all the confidential, all the classified emails. And that's a pretty ruthless attack. And that's how Anonymous retaliates against the perceived enemies it has. But I actually had a face-to-face meeting with an active member of Anonymous about a month ago. One member who had been part of Anonymous for 2 years or so, who was part of the Sony attacks, who had been running botnets for Anonymous, I invited him to our headquarters in Helsinki. I showed him around our labs. Having to have a discussion with the other researchers we have in the lab and showed some of the systems we use and so on. Why did I do that? Well, I did it because his father asked me to. His father asked me to try to speak some sense into his 13-year-old son. And this guy, he had been programming since the age of 9, had been building his own computers since the age of 11. And I asked him, like, why do you do this? I mean, you're obviously very smart. You seem like a guy who could do anything he wanted. Why are you part of this group? Why are you committing crimes online? Why are you attacking Sony? And I was sort of expecting the answer of the angry young man who wants to protest against something, right? And I didn't get that, because his answer was that the reason why he did all this was for laughs, for fun. He was bored, no other reason. And how do you even start to turn someone around when his only motive is to do it for laughs? And then we have the third group, the last group who we are fighting. And that's the nation states or attacks being launched by different countries. And we have different problems here. We have attacks which are espionage, spying from one country to another. Obviously, it's gone online because the information is online. The information is data. And then we have problems where governments are spying on their own citizens. This week, we have had massive headlines about the so-called Bundestrojan case in Germany, where German government has been using a Trojan to intercept computers of suspects in criminal investigations. And then we have problems like what we've had in Iran. Iran has been running an extended operation against dissidents or revolutionary people within Iran itself. And people like that inside Iran use the internet just like anyone else. But they know that the internet is run by the Iranian government. They know it can't be trusted, so they can't use local Iranian services because they are being watched. Instead, they use services like Gmail in USA, which are operated over SSL, so it's encrypted, so it's safe. The Iranian government can't intercept that. They can't intercept it because they can't generate fake SSL certificates, because Iran doesn't have a globally trusted certificate authority. So what did they do? Well, they hacked DigiNotar, a Dutch globally trusted certificate authority. Because once you hack a certificate authority like DigiNotar, you can generate keys or certificates for companies like Google, Skype, Hotmail, Yahoo, you name it, anything at all. And that's exactly what they did. And this is a real problem. But it's only a problem within Iran. This isn't going to affect anybody outside Iran, because for this to work, they have to be able to intercept the traffic and have a fake key. But it's actually perfectly possible people died because of this particular attack. It's perfectly possible that dissidents were caught because of this particular attack. And then we have probably the biggest single malware case in history, which is Stuxnet. Stuxnet, the first worm in history which targets automation systems. And this is important because all modern societies run on computers. You look at infrastructure and you look at critical infrastructure anywhere in the world. You go to any factory and you look around. You go to any chemical plant, any power plant, any food processing plant, and you just look around and you'll see that everything is automated, everything is being run by computers. In fact, most of them are being run by computers like this. This is Siemens S700 PLC. And that's what Stuxnet infects. And when Stuxnet infects PLCs, that's a game changer. Because now viruses have jumped from our computers to our automation gear. Stuxnet was very targeted. It didn't try to do anything at all anywhere else than in one single plant. And that plant was the Natanz nuclear enrichment plant in Iran. And Stuxnet was successful. It managed to break down, possibly explode, centrifuges which were doing uranium enrichment inside the Natanz plant. And once again, it's perfectly possible people died in that attack as well. When centrifuges explode, you'll have parts of carbon fiber flying around the room at speed of multiple hundreds of kilometers an hour and uranium gas everywhere. It's not a nice place to be. We don't know if that happened, but it's likely. So these cyber attacks, while they seem very virtual, actually aren't that virtual. You can have loss of life because of attacks like this. But then again, if I have to choose between cyber war and traditional war, well, I guess I would choose cyber war. There's less blood in cyber war. So we are relying on computers working all the time. And they don't work all the time. So what should we do about these problems? Well, we have three different problems I presented. How do we fight organized criminal gangs? Technical solutions are easy. Patch your system, take backups, run an antivirus, run a firewall. But that's actually doing nothing to stop the problem. That's like a band-aid. Yeah, we should do it, but that's not going to stop the problem. What's going to stop the problem is international police cooperation to actually catch the criminals and take them into jail. How do we solve problem number two? Hacktivists. Well, that's a problem which is going to solve itself. Because this is the next generation. That's the next generation that's growing up. The generation that doesn't remember the time before the internet was around. That can't understand how we ever found anything before Google. And they will grow up. And they will take control. And they will solve their old problems. Their own problems. And we, the current generation, will become extinct. We don't have to solve the problem. And then we have nation-state attacks. And that's a tough problem. Like, whose responsibility it is to actually defend against problems like that? Private security companies? Countries? Governments? Military? We don't actually know. And if it is the responsibility of private companies, like it is right now, then borders actually start to matter. Because normally it doesn't matter. Internet has no borders, no distances, no geography. In this case, it does. In this case, if you are worried about getting nation-state attacks from country A targeting your systems, do you really want to use an antivirus made in country A? Suddenly borders actually start to matter. And that, my friends, is why we need to defend the internet. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mikko Hypponen. Just a few quick questions. What is it exactly you're advocating? Some sort of international cyber police to fight computer crime?
That's exactly what I'm advocating. We have things like Interpol and Europol, which have been built decades ago to fight a completely different kind of a crime. They aren't really very well equipped against this problem, which has just appeared over the last 10 years. The key thing, though, there is to focus on the real problem, especially on this crime part, to these organized criminal gangs. I'm not advocating limiting the freedom of the net or, you know, hunting pirates. That's not the problem. The problem are these global gangs which make millions and steal it from all of us.
I noticed you were focusing on Windows as a target. Are those of us who are using the devices left to us by Steve Jobs, are they safe?
Yes, they are. That's easy.
Thank you very much.
The reason, of course, are the market shares. I mean, the attackers would be stupid to target. I mean, let's look at this.
So Windows, that might change then.
It's not just Windows as the target, it's Windows XP, which is still the most common operating system on the planet. It's 10 years old, it's the weakest, it's the biggest. That's mm-hmm. where they go. They go after the least secure and the biggest target. And I actually believe this is going to change within the next couple of years because the most common operating system on the planet at the current rate, will be Android. Android will be bypassing Windows, which might very well mean that we will start getting more and more attacks on the Android side.
We also got a question in for you through Twitter. Sydney Brower asks, have you or your... People seem to know him. Have you or your company ever been targets of hacking and retaliation?
Oh yes, we've been attacked multiple times. We've been hit by denial of service attacks. We've received threats. I mean, we spend most of our time working with the criminals, so that is to be expected.
Thank you very much. Mikko Hypponen.